This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream. Watch the extended version of this video when you sign up for CuriosityStream and Nebula using the link in the description. We don't really talk about hardware on this channel, in spite of the fact that we literally wouldn't have artificial intelligence and algorithms without it. From the CPU on your laptop to cloud GPU servers, when we talk about running machine learning models, we have to run it on something. In fact, it turns out that choosing that something to run our models on can be a bit more important than we may have realized. Welcome back to this somewhat out of order hardware series. Today we're going to focus on the paper that piqued my interest in this topic, which is called The Hardware Lottery by Sarah Hooker, a researcher at Google. And the paper essentially argues that while progress in AI research does require technical expertise and a lot of hard work, it also often depends on choosing the right hardware to run your systems on, and it's a choice that people aren't necessarily putting that much thought into. So before I dive into this, if you want the even deeper dive into this paper, you should check out the extended version on Nebula. If you want to keep learning about hardware and AI, subscribe and turn on your post notifications so that you know when the rest of the videos come up. Also, I recently started a Substack newsletter, which I'm planning on using as a kind of Patreon alternative. So if that's something that's interesting to you, then you can check it out and I'll leave a link in the description. All right. Let's get into this. So you might not have realized this, but the hardware that we use to train and run machine learning models, as well as actually the programming languages that we use to implement them, can have a significant effect on how well our model trains and whether or not it works at all. In fact, transformer models, which you probably know better as models like GPT-3, are a great example of this. There's been a lot of recent work that shows that transformer optimization is actually pretty hard, and how you initialize your model goes a long way towards making sure you have a transformer that actually performs well at the end. And interestingly, a lot of the methods that we use to optimize transformers are things that work, but we don't necessarily know why. For a deeper dive into transformer models, as well as natural language processing broadly, I'm actually going to be doing an NLP month, an NLP series next month in April, so stay tuned for that. Now, the significance of hardware as it relates to the task that's being performed on it actually tracks back to early computer history. Early computers were typically task-specific out of necessity. We didn't have systems that we could run multiple programs on at the time, which we actually talked about in the neuromorphic computing video. It wasn't until the late 60s that we started seeing general purpose computers where you could run multiple programs on them. And in that case, it wasn't even necessarily at the same time. So what changed between those old task-specific computers and the newer general purpose models? In short, transistors, new computer architectures, and of course, Moore's Law. So let's talk about computer architectures really briefly. So computer architectures describe the functionality, organization, and implementation of computer systems. This includes things like how your computer memory is connected to the processor or how the computer actually executes instructions. The von Neumann architecture is a common one that we've talked about in other videos, including in the neuromorphic computing video, but as we talked about in the neuromorphic computing video, as well as the edge computing video, there are other approaches to computer architectures that may work better for different types of problems. In fact, originally computer architectures were task specific because computers, as I mentioned, were only really designed to perform one task, and so you could customize your architecture based on what you needed to do. Now, from the 1980s to about the 2010s, we actually switched over from those more task specific architectures to general purpose computers. And this is because in the past, domain specific computers were the most efficient way of completing tasks within a certain domain. However, as we started to see transistor size drop and started to have more computing power on any given computer, it got to the point where that next gen general purpose computer had more computing power and was probably cheaper than specialized hardware. Okay, so how much cheaper was that generalized hardware? Well, it's not so much that the generalized hardware is cheaper, and it's more that the process of creating a new chip is very expensive, and if it's not something that a good number of people can use enough to make it worth your time and your money, people aren't necessarily interested in investing that money in specialized hardware. So to give you some numbers, producing a specialized chip typically costs between $30 and $80 million and takes 2 to 3 years to develop. This also assumes that you already have the resources to create that kind of hardware. So in 2017, the Semiconductor Industry Association estimated that it costs about $7 billion to construct a new fabrication center. And these costs have reduced the number of semiconductor manufacturers from 25 in 2002 to just 4 today. In Intel, Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company, Samsung, and GlobalFoundries. If you look to the research space, Google's TPU, or Tensor Processing Unit, took them about 4 years to develop, and while they don't say how expensive it was, you can guess that it's probably comparable to other specialized chips. So you can see why people weren't necessarily interested in investing money in creating new specialized hardware for domain-specific tasks, but the problem with this is that the available hardware that people can use actually impacts model performance. And a really easy example of this is the fact that we had the math and arguably the ability to write code to make deep neural networks since the 1960s. But the reason why they didn't become particularly popular until the early 2000s was because we didn't really have the hardware to make them useful. Von Neumann CPU architectures were common in computers at the time, but aren't optimized to do matrix calculations, which is like 90% of machine learning. And GPUs had actually been around since the 1970s, but they weren't really repurposed for machine learning until the early 2000s. And now they're being used for crypto. Interestingly, programming languages at the time were also primarily symbolic, which is to say they represented certain types of problems, which is great for problems within those domains, but if you're trying to develop a deep neural network and that doesn't fit with whatever programming language you're using, it makes it very hard to actually create code to run these types of models, and generally added to the challenge of implementing deep learning systems. And this is all to say that the hardware that you pick actually has an impact on a lot of different aspects of your code and of your model performance, and in ways that you might not really think about on a day-to-day basis. So we have all these issues with hardware and a lot of the tension between having specialized hardware that might help us make better models and general purpose hardware that's going to sell more is ultimately based in capitalism, but what does that mean for the models that we have today? Essentially, it means that some amount of progress is determined by either having access to or intentionally choosing the correct hardware, and that we might be able to make more progress in certain fields if we had that kind of hardware. For example, model compression is an area of research that focuses on creating sparser models or models with fewer weights. That way you can scale them back down. Ideally, these models use less energy. They can be put onto smaller systems like we talked about in the edge computing video, and would also maybe tell us more about how models make decisions in a more interpretable way because you wouldn't have 7.5 billion parameters to get through. The problem is that model compression often leads to something called model forgetting, which is where models become biased against data that is underrepresented in the larger training data set. And this obviously ties into bigger issues of algorithmic fairness and bias within machine learning research. There have been a lot of interesting proposed solutions and techniques to combat this, but some of the most interesting and most effective ones actually don't work on our current hardware. Another current issue is one that we actually talked a bit about earlier, which is the fact that creating specialized chips requires essentially 2 to 3 years of lead time. And because the field is moving so quickly, it can be really hard to predict what's going to be useful in 3 years. So, what's next? Well, it kind of depends. Hooker proposes a lot more work on algorithmic self-monitoring and diagnosis, so algorithmic systems that can optimize hardware in the process of developing and training algorithms to make it so that they work better and more efficiently for the algorithms themselves, as well as increased public funding of hardware research, which is often where a lot of the initial research happens, so they can prove that these actually work before companies are willing to actually foot the bill in the manufacturing process. She also proposes domain-specific software development as a way of kind of getting around the hardware issue, but doing so effectively abstracts your hardware, which kind of circles back to the original same problem when we could just be developing better hardware. So in the interest of time, I'm going to stop here, but I actually ended up diving a lot deeper into this paper in the Nebula Plus version of this video. If you're new to my channel, Nebula is a creator-built platform where you get to watch my videos ad-free, and me and some other creators you've probably heard of can create and experiment with awesome content without having to worry about demonetization or paying tribute to the YouTube algorithm. We're thrilled to be partnering with CuriosityStream, a subscription streaming service with thousands of documentaries and nonfiction videos. Want to learn more about new hardware? Check out the Nano Revolution to learn more about nanotechnology and how it might revolutionize everything from medicine to climate. And where CuriosityStream is all about big budget nonfiction documentaries, we're building Nebula so that education creators have a place to make content that might not work so well on YouTube. On Nebula, you'll find ad-free videos from some of your favorite creators, from Tierzoo to Neurotransmissions to The Coding Train, as well as my Nebula Plus content, which includes journal clubs of interest interesting papers and extended versions of the videos you see on my channel. You'll also find Nebula originals like Tom Scott's Game Show Money or Very Good Trivia Show, where Sam from Wendover challenges myself, Real Engineering, and City Beautiful to a bunch of interesting and a bit bizarre challenges. CuriosityStream loves independent creators and wants to help us grow our platform, so if you click on the link in the description or use my promo code Jordan, you can get access to CuriosityStream for 26% off their annual plans, with Nebula included for free for as long as you are a CuriosityStream member. That's less than $15 a year. Signing up for CuriosityStream and Nebula is a great way to directly support my channel while getting to watch my videos ad-free and getting that extra deep dive into this paper. So sign up for CuriosityStream and Nebula using the promo code Jordan or at curiositystream.com/Jordan. Otherwise, if you like this video, let me know by smashing the like button and subscribing to my channel. You can also check out the rest of the hardware series on this playlist up here. If you want to follow my PhD life, you can do so on Twitter and Instagram, and I'll see y'all on Monday. Bye!